Hi everyone, it's Emma here, and today I am talking about pregnancy and our periods, the menstrual cycle. So this is something we actually get asked about quite a lot, so I just want to really run through what areas I can help answer, and then also point out just when it's time to go to the doctor rather than ourselves at Avogel to help. So yes, talking about the pregnancy and our periods and things, there are different areas that we can talk about. So first of all, we have if someone was to fall pregnant, what happens to her periods then? Also, for women who have quite irregular or missed periods, they might often wonder if they are pregnant. So what are some of the signs of that? And then talking about symptoms of PMS versus pregnancy as well. So whether or not those your periods are quite regular. Every month we do get symptoms, although some more mild than others, but some of those could actually be mistaken for pregnancy symptoms as well. So just to talk through a bit of some of the similarities there and why these symptoms can often look quite similar. So first of all, I'm going to start through what are the signs of pregnancy versus those normal monthly symptoms. So it certainly can be confusing, and unfortunately some of the early signs of pregnancy can be quite similar to PMS. So I'm just going to run through some of those typical symptoms that there's a little bit of crossover on and explain why. So first of all, we have cramps. So stomach cramps are really quite characteristic of women who experience PMS. They get those quite characteristic cramps every month, often a day or two before their period and then perhaps a few days into their period. But also when we fall pregnant, we can also experience similar sensations as well. The cramps we experience as part of our period are often as a result of the womb contracting and prostaglandins being released as the lining of our womb is shed. And in terms of pregnancy, we can experience some cramps when the egg, fertilized egg, embeds in the lining of your womb. So those sensations can be quite similar, which is why we could potentially experience cramps in either situation. Next, we have tender breasts. So again, this is a common PMS symptom, and also it can be an early sign of pregnancy as well. And this is mainly due to the balance of hormones that we experience. So to give rise to our period, estrogen levels tend to drop off particularly quickly, which means progesterone levels are slightly higher in ratio, and also progesterone is particularly high in very early pregnancy, and then estrogen levels kind of catch up, but it's that progesterone dominance at both those times which can potentially give rise to similar symptoms such as those tender breasts. Low levels of energy is next. Again, this is really quite similar to the reasons for the tender breasts, that estrogen is very nice for helping to maintain lots of functions and help us feel quite energized. So if progesterone is a little bit higher relative to estrogen, then potentially we could feel a little bit low in energy. Particularly in pregnancy, this can carry on. There's lots of changes going on, and it does use up quite a lot of energy. But we're talking very early stages here, where we might still be mistaking the symptoms for symptoms of PMS. Sweating, feeling warmer than usual, again, it's down to those balance in hormones. Many women notice that they feel warmer or even very, very mild hot flush type symptoms in the lead up to their period, or night sweats. And in early pregnancy as well, just again, down to those balance of hormones, that could also be experienced as well. The last one on my list is nausea. Again, unfortunately, due to those dropping hormones, it can be a symptom that can affect women with PMS. The estrogen levels falling off can cause some havoc with our digestive system. This is also particularly characteristic of pregnancy, and this is due to rising pregnancy hormone that we call HCH, and this can potentially make us feel a little bit sick, nauseous, or we may actually be sick. So again, early stages, this could start to manifest, and then it could continue a little further into pregnancy, and in many cases in PMS, once your periods start and your hormones start to rise again, that usually that symptom should start to tail off. So next I'm just going to look at some of the symptoms in terms of what can happen to your menstrual cycle if you were to fall pregnant. So in many cases, this falling pregnant would result in a missed period, which is quite normal. But of course, there are some cases where we experience a little bit of bleeding during pregnancy. And I'll just run through some common factors there, and of course, when to see your doctor. So the first scenario is implantation bleeding. So this would usually happen at the very, very, very early stage of pregnancy. So before we may even know that we're pregnant. And as I mentioned above, this is a result of the egg implanting in the womb. So the lining of the womb is very full, and that egg implanting could cause you to lose a little bit of that lining and experience a little bleed. So this is possibly a few days before you even were to know that you were pregnant. So that would be something to potentially look out for. Also during pregnancy, in some cases, the balance of hormones can potentially cause some bleeding. So it's not unheard of, but we would always to say to get this checked. So hormones, the forming placenta, the cervix, these can all potentially give rise to some bleeding or spotting, which in some cases is normal. But as soon as you're aware you're pregnant and experience any bleeding, we would of course tell you to get that checked, and your doctor or midwife can tell you more as to what might be causing it. The next question I often get asked is, can you become pregnant during your period? So this is if you're on your period and you were to have sex, could you fall pregnant? So although it's less likely that you would fall pregnant during your period, this all depends on ovulation. So it depends on how well you're tracking your symptoms, if you're quite aware of when you ovulate or not. Especially women who have shorter cycles, or if they're aware that their ovulation is quite irregular, potentially sperm can survive in the body for up to 5-6 days even. So if you were to have sex and then you were to ovulate quite soon after your period, then there is the chance that you could fall pregnant. Although on average it's less likely, it still potentially could happen. So we would obviously stress just to be aware of that and take precautions, because although, as I say, it's less likely, it technically could still happen depending on when you ovulate. So next question we often get asked about how to help increase your chances of pregnancy. So I would say that this isn't our area of expertise, and we shouldn't go into too much detail. You should see a specialist around this. Just to give you some background in the area, there's so many different factors that can potentially influence this. So you've got your cycle itself, if and when you're ovulating, so that's a crucial factor. And of course, you're trying to understand your cycle a little bit better is always going to be a good start. How often you're having sex, again around the time of ovulation, is going to be crucial as well, so trying to understand and plan around that. And then we have all the diet and lifestyle factors in terms of nutrient deficiencies. There's lots of nutrients, both for males and females, which help to support fertility. So we have nutrients such as zinc, magnesium, the B vitamins, vitamin C, vitamin E, those two are lovely antioxidants. These all help to support the balance of our hormones that is behind ovulation, and then maintaining a pregnancy. One thing I will just touch on quickly before I finish up is our agnescastis, because we often get asked about a little contraindication that's mentioned on the leaflet, which says you shouldn't take agnescastis if you're pregnant or trying to become pregnant or breastfeeding. So it's just to explain a little bit about that. Basically, the agnescastis is not licensed for infertility or fertility issues. It's only licensed for symptoms of PMS, which that means this is what we can legally recommend it for. So infertility shouldn't be, we can't recommend it as being suitable for self-medication. So in that way, you should stick to the agnescastis for managing the symptoms of PMS and those underlying hormone imbalances related to that only. What I would say though, is if you were taking the agnescastis and were to fall pregnant, then you should just stop taking it straight away. So hopefully that helps. Thanks for watching, and please subscribe to our Able Go channel to see more videos. Also, if you click the bell icon, you will be notified when I do any new videos.